Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message, and that you'll share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John continues the series entitled, The Letter to the Romans. Christians should interact with everyone. This means that when someone is happy, we rejoice with them. And when someone is grieving, we provide comfort as they work it out. We should strive to be in agreement with other Christians. Can you imagine how the world would be better if there was unity and denominations came to an end? We should also never look down upon other people. A deeply committed Christian is never proud and condescending. Likewise, we should never take revenge and rejoice in the pain experienced by others. This type of behavior is not sanctioned by God anywhere in the Bible. If you claim Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then you should strive to eliminate any kind of deceit in your life. Don't be contentious and create strife. Be peaceful and a good neighbor. Finally, love your enemies and reach out to them. This message is entitled, Christian Conduct. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And I'm very happy to have you here today, on the last Sunday of the month of April 2017. And today is going to be a nice message, not too controversial, and simply how we should live as Christians. And something we need to be reminded how we should live as believers in Christ. Heavenly Father, I thank you right now for touching us. Thank you, Father God, for using me today to bring this message that Father God would simply change people and help them to live and walk in Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. The other day, there was an incident here in our this building where we have our chapel and our offices. And my nephew, Charles, his wife, Katarina, have six children. And I was going to walk in, come up in the ramp, and I saw two of his children, one girl and one boy, coming down fast, and Charles behind them, red in the face, very angry, and apparently had done something that he should not have done. So I wondered, what was he going to do as a father? So they passed me, and he took them down here to the end of the ramp. And he told them this, you stay here until you make up. And when you have asked the other for forgiveness, come and see me. I said, well, never seen that before. So he walked in. So they were about 3-4 minutes out there. And then they both came up, working up the ramp, walking up the ramp, came in, made a beeline to the father, stood in front of him. I could see them straight like this and just ask him to forgive them, and they were corrected. This is what we as believers in Christ, we need to be corrected from time to time. Because sometimes we hurt each other. And church business meetings can be the most horrible things that you can simply experience. And when you go to church, sometimes you know you have people come from different directions and we don't know each other. And for some reason we don't like to really open up, you know, to meet somebody new. And, you know, we simply stay with the people we know. And, you know, we really should open up ourselves. If we have newcomers, simply, you know, let them know that God loves them and we love them. And like one pastor said, there's always room in the church. If not, we will make more room. So the Apostle Paul wrote here some one-liners. And so we're going to look first on sympathize. And let's begin in Romans 12, 15. That's Romans 12, 15. Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that weep. What does that mean? It simply means this. People have needs. There are times I get depressed. There are times I get sad. There are times I'm very happy. And here's the deal. When you have something really great happening to you, you want to share that. You don't want to sit all by yourself and say, oh, bless the Lord, you know, I got all this good stuff happening to me. You want to pick up the phone and call somebody and say, you know what? God really blessed me today. And the other person said, really? Okay. All right. Have a good day. You need to rejoice. When somebody gets a new car, somebody gets healed, somebody have this or that occasion, you know, we should say, great, you know, tell me more about it. Let's rejoice together. Or when somebody has died, you need to share their griefs. And, you know, it is not, you know, helping too much. Somebody lose somebody, died, really good. Could be a family member, whatever. And you go up and say, well, praise the Lord, brother. You're going to see them in eternity. Just don't weep too much more, you know. Just move on. You know, when you're grieving, you don't need that. What do we need when somebody grieves? We need compassion. What kind of compassion? Not phony compassion. But you simply realize this. Someday, my mom is going to die. Someday, my husband might die. Someday, you know, I'll lose my child. How will I feel? Just being with a person, encourage them, loving them, maybe giving them a little meal or something, whatever you can do. Encouragement. Just sitting, maybe not saying a whole lot, and just being there as a friend. Let's look in Psalms chapter 33. That's the book of Psalms, the 33rd chapter. Psalm 33, and verses 1 through 4. Let me read this. Rejoice in the Lord, O you righteous, for praise is commanded for the upright. Praise the Lord with harp, sing unto him with psaltery, and an instrument of 10 strings. Sing unto him a new song, play skillfully with a loud noise. For the word of the Lord is right, and all his works are done in truth. He loves righteousness and judgment. The earth is full of goodness of the Lord. When my father died, that particular day we were having a repair in the bathroom. We were putting in a new floor. And, of course, you don't plan on, you know, that this is the day you're going to die. You make appointments, you know, with the undertaker and so on. So when you die, you don't expect to die. When I say die, the body. So my dad passed away. And this contractor was going to come in, and he was going to work on the floor. And he said, I'm not going to work on the floor today because we had other things to do. And I expected him to leave. So an hour later, I found him in the backyard, sitting in a chair and praying. I said, what happened to you? He said, I know you lost your dad. And he said, I just was going to sit there and pray for you and pray for the family. And I thought, you know, that was nice. That was loving. If I hadn't gone back, I would not have seen him. So the small things that we can do when somebody has a need, somebody's rejoicing, So let's turn to Luke. Matter of fact, let me go on to Psalms 35. It's Psalms 35. If you're going to read the following verses, 13 through 14. But as for me, when they were sick, my clothing was sackcloth. I humbled my soul with fasting, and my prayer returned into my own bosom. I behaved myself as though he had been my friend or brother. I bowed down heavily, as one that mourns for his mother. So David said, when people were sick, they died, or whatever happened, he was there for them. And then Luke chapter 1:56. It's the Gospel of Luke. If you pick it up, it's the Gospel of Luke chapter 1. And this is probably a verse that we don't read that often. Verses 56 through 58. And Mary abode with her about 3 months and returned to her own house, at the mother of Jesus. Now Elizabeth, that's the mother of John the Baptist, full time came that she should be delivered, and she brought forth a son. And her neighbors and the cousins heard how the Lord had showed great mercy upon her, and they rejoiced with her. So rejoice with people that have joy. Weep and be comforted to those that are grieving. Because Jesus said, do unto others as you want them to do unto you. And I'm sure that you and I have needs. I like to be comforted. I like to have someone to share my joy with. Because God has made us. None of us are loners. No one of us really work well isolated. We need love. We need compassion. We need caring. No one is tough enough that can say, well, I don't need anyone. God made us to love and to be loved. And if we do not do that, we get warped and our souls are hurting. The next point we're going to look upon is to be like-minded. And let's go back into Romans chapter 12. It's Romans, the 12th chapter. And we want to pick it up in 16a, 12:16. Be of the same mind, one toward another. Is it important we be of the same mind? In the chapel here today, a number of people have gathered. We come from different backgrounds and different vocations, different circumstances. We had one thing in common today. We got up and we made up our mind that we're going to go to church. So, you drove here. I had a long commute. I walked here. And when we came here, we came with a purpose to pray, to read the Word, to get into the Word, to be ministered to, and to be kind to one another. That's what we came, like-minded. Now, we are like I said, we are very different. But you see, as Christians, we can be like-minded. There's one thing I was listening to Donald Trump's rally yesterday. And it was something that I didn't think about at first, but it struck me later. And that was this. I heard him say that before. He said, it doesn't matter what color we are, what race we are, and so on. We are one blood, made by our Creator. Think about that. He rejected evolution. And of course, that went over like a lead balloon on the liberals, on the leftists, and the communists. But we have a common Father, our Heavenly Father. And we all are traced back to Noah, his three sons, and their wives. And Noah is traced back to Adam and Eve. One blood. So we can be like-minded. And I want to remind you of this. If you go to Japan, or you go to Laos, or you go to any particular country, you will find that people have the same feelings. They want to have a home. They like to have a family. They like their children. They like work. They like to have a car. They like to have good food. We are all the same on this earth. And yet, Satan has taken us and caused wars where nation goes against war. And we kill each other. For what? Nothing. A war solves nothing. In Romans 15:5, Paul said this. Likewise, let me make sure I get to the right place here. Romans chapter 5, verse 16. Here we go, 15, verses 5 through 7. Now the God of patience and consolation granted to be like-minded one to one another, according to Christ Jesus, that you may with one mind and one mouth glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. What do we have in common? Number one, those of us in the chapel today, I believe, are all saved. We have in common that we have repented of our sins, received Christ as our Lord and Savior, and we have been born again. We also believe this, that people need to be saved. So we do mission work. Now, most people cannot go out and do mission work per se. So what we do is we pool our resources. Right now, this webcast is going out. This is a mission outreach, and it's possible because we pooled our resources to have the money to do this. We also have this in common, that we believe that Jesus is coming back. We also have this in common, we believe that in marriage is between one man and one woman. We also have this in common, that we believe that homosexuality is a sin. And we can go down the line, there's a lot of things we have in common. Now, when it comes to music, some people like it loud, some people like it this way, some people like it that way, and so on. That really doesn't make any difference. Some people says, well, we want to have the piano on this side or the organ on that side, you know, they fight over that. Big deal. Who cares? These are not big issues. We agree upon the big stuff, and then we love one another. Remember this, all of us are peculiar. Every one of us got habits that will drive somebody else nuts. Except me, I got no bad habits, I'm perfect. So what we need to do is, we need to recognize this, it's okay. Somebody bites a fingernail, you know, well, pray for them, you know, but, you know. Don't club them. You know, let's be nice to one another. Like-minded. I'm going to skip 1 Corinthians 1:10, but I'm going to go to Philippians. I thought this was going to be a short sermon. Philippians chapter 2. And we're going to pick it up here in verse number 2 through 5. fulfill you my joy, that you be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind. Let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Beautiful verses. Have you ever been to a church dinner? You know, they can be pretty rough sometimes. You know, I've been to dinners where some people, you know, they're used to standing in line, and as soon as you hear the word, amen, you know, they rush the tables. They want to be first, and they hog all the good food and leave the rest of the fillers, you know, for the rest of the guys. You know, we have a church dinner. We should be polite. It's not like you go to a restaurant, you know, you try to elbow yourself to the front. But, you know, be nice. Be courteous. Help each other. You don't have to be first in line. There's so many things that we do sometimes that hurt one another. Now, let me talk about something else. I'm going to meddle now. When we come to church, most of the time we are nice, smiling. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Right? Now, we treat other people nice. But when we leave church, we get in the car, most of the time, the voices change. What's wrong with you? I don't want to go home right now. I want to go and eat. I don't want to go and eat. The civility is gone. And you know why? We treat our loved ones the worst. Because we have nothing to lose. You see, they know us. We don't have to care for, you know, what people think about us. Strangers, you want them to think well of you. Family, yeah, they know you. You get cut down all the time, you know, so who cares? And this is sad. We should treat the wife, the husband, the children, the parents, the nicest. These are the closest to us. These are the ones we should love the most. And these are the ones we are grumpy, short, to the point. What's wrong with you? Can't you do anything right? And then we wonder, where did the love go? You know, when you dated that beautiful woman or that handsome man, that's not how you spoke. Nice language. Honey bun, can I open a car door for you? Yeah. Oh boy. Lot of oil. Lot of good stuff. You know what? The honeymoon is short. Sad. Really should think about that. Don't be a snob. Turn to Romans 12 again, verse number 16. That's Romans chapter 12. If you look at verse 16 here now. Mind not how things, but condescend to men a low estate. What does that mean? Have you noticed this? If you go to a post office, you go to DMV, you go to a government office, and you'll find, you know, the clerks are the lowest level, are the nastiest of them all. they like to be king. Stand in line. Quiet. Then you take a boss. He's nice most of the time. The reason why it is insecurity and inferiority. If you are secure yourself and you know who you are, you don't have to prove yourself to anyone. You can be nice. And it doesn't matter what people say to you, you can be nice to them. But when you are insecure, inferiority, we have to prove ourselves to show our status. I'm important. I work at McDonald's. You better behave, I won't sell you a hamburger. We need to simply think about to be kind. Now, so you got a doctor's degree or doctorate, or you might be a lawyer, an attorney, whatever it is. We don't have to tell people, you know, I want you to know something. I am a great person. Here are my degrees. And these are the people that are, you know, I have this and that. A person having to do that is childish, has an arrested development spirit, insecure. Because as a human being, if you're a janitor, or if you're a CEO, you're a person. Made in the image of God. The level before the cross, the ground before the cross is level. So, you know, it's nice to simply say to somebody, you know what, hi, how are you? You don't have to tell them who you are. Nice to see you, talk to them, you know, be nice. You don't have to always pretend, you know, well, you know, I don't talk to people like that, that lower class people, you know, so I want to be with the big shots. Yesterday, we went to a place, and my wife had a feet done. She needed a little feet work. We went to this place. I'd never been there before. I think they were Laotians from Laos. Nice bunch of people. They're very courteous. So normally here in California, do your feet is about $40 or a little bit more. So this lady spent an hour with my wife, and I came up and said, how much is this? She said, $22. I said, $22? Can I write a check? Yes. So I wrote a check, and I wrote it for more than $22. So I gave it to her. She looked at the check, and she smiled. You know, like, you know, I gave her a gift. She's worth it. Now, she did what Jesus did. You know, they did a feat, washed the feet. And she worked hard. And so I simply wanted her to know this. We appreciate it. I thanked her for ministering to my wife's faith. This is how you want to be. Simple. Down to earth. Not high-minded. And God can use you. Learn to Psalm 131. It's Psalms 131. It is so wonderful to be yourself. You don't have to fake anything. They talk about fake news. There's a lot of fake people. 131. And let me find, that's 119. So, here we go. Psalm 131. The first three verses. Lord, my heart is not haughty, nor my eyes lofty, neither I exercise myself in great matters or in things too high for me. Surely I have behaved and quieted myself as a child that is weaned of his mother. My soul is even as a weaned child. That is the hope of the Lord from henceforth and forever. Can you say that? Is that you? If not, we need a change. We need to simply say, Lord, I don't want to be like this. I want to change. Let me take it up to Proverbs chapter 3. That's Proverbs, the third chapter. If you pick it up here in verse number 5 through 8. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him. He shall direct your path. Be not wise in your own ways. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It shall be health to your navel and marrow to your bones. Your immune system will be healed. In all your ways acknowledge him, God. He shall direct your path. Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. So we need to recognize you don't have all the answers. I do not have all the answers. I learned this years ago. As a pastor, evangelist, a writer, I cannot be doing everything. I cannot cover every subject. It's impossible. So I work in certain areas that God had told me to work in. I use other people's work. I give them credit. Why should I reinvent the wheel when they've done it? So I save myself time. And sometimes people come up and ask me a question, what about this? And I said, well, I don't know. Haven't thought about that. Haven't studied that. Never heard that. So I don't know. I'm not going to be an idiot. And says, well, here's my opinion on it. You know, I don't know. So I only give answers to what I know. So it is okay to say, I don't know. I haven't read that. Don't know that. It's okay. You don't have to know it all. Know what God told you to know. And then do that well. Don't be conceited. High-minded. Let's turn straight to 2 Chronicles 7. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. Familiar verses. And this is this. If I shut up heaven that there be no rain, if I command the locusts to devour the land, if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Now mine eyes shall be open and mine ears intent unto the prayer that is made in this place. Let's not be high-minded. Do you realize this now? We are Christians. You that are watching, some of you might not be, but you want to be. And you people in the chapel here are Christians. Now, what we should do is this. We should be thankful. Do you realize, and I said this many times, and I'm going to hammer it in, you could have been born in Saudi Arabia and you would have been a Muslim. You could have been born in Japan and you would have been a Buddhist. You could have been born in India, you would have been a Hindu. You could be born any place. Now, was it your smartness that made you a Christian? Was it because you're so intelligent? Did you select your parents? Do you select the country where you're born in? Did we beforehand say, okay, Lord, this is what I want to do? No. We had no choice. We were born by the will of God in the country we were born in. We have nothing to brag about. We cannot say, well, we are Americans. We are, because God said so, and he had us born here, or we came here. So we need to get down from our horses. And when you see a Muslim, when you see a Hindu, when you see a Buddhist, whatever they are, have compassion on them. And say at least a prayer. Lord, save that person. Lord, it could have been me. If you come to that place and realize the grace that God had on us, then God can begin to use us. We're not smart. We're not special. We are thankful. And whatever we do, it's the Holy Spirit in us, not our intelligence. Don't take vengeance. Let's turn straight to Hebrews chapter 10. That's Hebrews, the 10th chapter. And I want to read the following verses, 30 through 31. For we know him that said, vengeance belongs unto me. I will recompense, says the Lord. And again the Lord shall judge his people. It's a fearful thing to fold the hands of the living God. Vengeance belongs to me. I will recompense. As a Christian, we don't have the right to take revenge. I want it to sink in now. Regardless of what people do to you, we do not have the legal, spiritual right to take revenge. You know, before you got saved, before you came close to God, we took revenge at times. And at first, it was a bittersweet feeling when we saw something bad happen to that person. We did him in. But then, that bittersweet feeling turned into bitter. And you recognize there was nothing there. Jesus is love. When Jesus hung on the cross, before he got on the cross, when they nailed him, had him flat on his back, took his hands and nailed him to the cross piece. He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. That's hard to pray that kind of prayer. But that's how God wants us to live. Today, I'm showing you from the Bible a higher way to live, a higher standard. And if you strive for that, you will be blessed, very blessed. And then the next point, be honest. We ought to work hard, we ought to be honest, and we not to steal. Let's turn to Proverbs chapter 6. It's Proverbs, the 6th chapter. We pick it up from verse number 6. Go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider ways and be wise. Which having no guide, overseer, or ruler, provides the meat of the summer and gathers the food in the harvest. How long would you sleep, you sluggard? When will you rise out of your sleep? Yet there is sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to sleep. So shall your poverty come as one that travails and he wants as an armed man. God intends for us to work. we're not to be idle. God did not prepare man to perpetually play golf or to perpetually do surfing, whatever it is. We have recreation, but God created us to work, be fruitful, multiply, subdue the earth. Jesus told it to Adam, Genesis chapter 1. When we work for the Lord. You might have a bad boss, but you see, you're not working for the bad boss. You're not working for the company. You're working for the Lord. This is how God wants it, to be totally honest. Let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. That's 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Now, I was raised in a socialist home, social democrats. And my parents hated the company they work for. They work for a factory called Husqvarna. They called Husqvarna here. I can't pronounce it, but I can say Husqvarna. They make sewing machines, motorcycles, lawnmowers, and all kind of different stuff they made. And I remember my parents talking bad. And they were stealing. They simply took home stuff from work. And it says, well, we're underpaid, you know, they make money on us. They are, you know, we are their slaves, you know, they're taking advantage of us and blah, blah, blah. So that was the attitude I got. That's what I learned. But you know what? Someone that runs a factory, someone that runs a little business, a store, whatever it is, they are working harder because they have to work so that other people can work there. It's easy to work for yourself. If you got people working for you, you got to come in early. You got to do this. You got to do that. You got to take care of all the things. And the guy that shows up for work, he comes in, put his card in, click, he's in, you know, that's it. Walks home, done. So we really should appreciate those people that creates jobs. Because workers do not create jobs. There are special people that are gifted, entrepreneurs. If it is a business, a store, whatever it is, people are gifted and they create jobs for other people. If we didn't have entrepreneurs, there would be no jobs. Not everyone can be a leader. There are different people, different gifts. So 2 Corinthians, let me get there, chapter 8. 2 Corinthians, chapter 8, and we're going to read from verse 21. Providing for honest things, not only in the sight of the Lord, but also in the sight of men. Providing for honest things, not only in the sight of the Lord, but also in the sight of men. You and I would drive around, and when we hit potholes, roads are bad, we complain, right? So we've got to pay a little bit taxes so they can fix the roads. Have you ever thought about the people working on the road? We get upset, you know, oh, road work again, slow down. These guys are risking their lives. People get killed working for the highway department. These people are working long hours, cold in the wintertime, hot in the summertime, and they are laboring for you and me so we can drive our cars on a smooth surface. We should appreciate that. You see, all of us When we work, we are serving others. You go to the grocery store. Have you ever thought about this? Somebody is stocking that stuff there. You have that guy that checks you out at that counter. He stands there, you know, and put the stuff in. He serves you. Somebody's bagging your grocery. You look at that guy that bags you, don't say, nah, man, you know, what a disaster. He's serving you. You and I, we are serving one another. In a society, we are servants. But everyone working and doing something, we are serving one another. If you ride a bus, if you go to the service station, whatever it is, you want service. So let me do our work. We do it as unto the Lord. And then in Exodus 20:15, I'm just going to quote it. You shall not steal. Period. Stealing is taking something that doesn't belong to you. So you are in a store, you get them a 20, and you get back $10 more than you should. You smile, walk out, say, man, I just made 10 bucks. You stole 10 bucks, not yours. We need to be honest in small things. Because you say, you want other people to be honest. You want people, when you go to a restaurant, you go to a service station, or wherever you go, you want to have first-class service, right? You don't want someone that's a jerk and say, you know, what do you want? Can you tell me this item is? No, I'm not going to tell you that. Go lick yourself. Man, I don't have time for you. You want a clerk that says, sure, we have this in the store. Please let me take you there and I show you where it's at, right? You like that? Yeah. We should do the same thing. If you learn that, be honest, work hard, don't steal. Now, be peaceful. Romans 12:18. I think I can finish this sermon today. Romans 12:18. If it be possible, as much as lies in you, live peaceable with all men. If it be possible, there are some people you can't get along with. You just have to walk away from them. There are some people that you just can't handle. If it be possible, as much as lies in you, live peaceably with all men. And then in Rome, in Hebrews 12:14, that's Hebrews 12:14. Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Sometime in a church setting, there were two people who were upset with one another. And as a pastor, I came up to these people and said, you know, can we cool it down? And have you ever been with people that are really, I mean, they overheated? I mean, mouth is open, full volume, screaming at the top of the lungs. People think, you know, the more I scream, you know, the more intelligent I am. And, you know, some say, you know, don't tell me that, you know, blah, 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 blah. So, yeah. So one guy took a swing, you know, almost hit me, you know, so finally we got to my part. That was in church. Now, be peaceable. It's easy when we got a few people to be peaceable. But if you've got 1,000 people and you don't know them, and you're driving to church and you find this guy, he's just, yep, right in front of you, take the parking place. Oh, man. And there's not a parking place in sight. Ah. So you have to drive around and you walk a long way to the church. And guess what? You got seated next to those people. Well. You want to do a little elbow on them. I need more room. Be peaceable. Have you ever had it happen to you when you go to the store and you've just been waiting a long time? You just waited to come up, you know, somebody come right in. Kill him. Road rage. So what we need to do is to slow down. Take a breath in. I don't have to get mad. It's not the end of the world. I find something else. God bless you, man. You ever had someone, you go to a grocery store, you're in a hurry, you're walking down, and just you're ready to go in, someone comes in and takes a slot before you with a big cart full of stuff. You look at that person, excuse me. You want to take that person like this and jump them back, kick the cart over and say, you know, take your place, man. Be peaceable. So if you lose your place, whatever it is, and you lose a few seconds in life, what is worth more? The peace of God or that you have the right? And you put them in place. Ask yourself this. What would Jesus do if that were him? Would he curse them out? No. So we need to be peaceful. And I tell you what. A peaceful man and a woman never have a problem with ulcers. You don't have to take Tums and other things, you know, for your stomach. Your stomach is going to be just fine. It is when we are stressed out, almost like a Doberman, you know. That's when our stomach doesn't work too well. Last point. Tough one. Love your enemy. Romans 12, 19. Romans 12, chapter 19. And, dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath, with written, vengeance mine I will repay, says the Lord. Therefore your enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing you shall heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. That doesn't mean that if you're in your house and you have a home invasion, people break in, that you say, oh, folks, how nice, welcome. That's okay, you broke the door handle and stuff like that. That's fine, you know. What would you like to have? I have coffee, tea, you know, or your cold drink? Or what would you like to have? No, you serve them with one of these. That's what you serve them when they do home invasion. But you know, afterwards, you can love the enemies, you know, and simply say, I'm very sorry I had to make some holes in you, you know. But, you know, I'll pray for you. Okay? So there are times, you know, when we simply have to be firm. The Bible doesn't say you lay down, let them choke you and kill you. It doesn't say that. We have the right to resist. And we need to resist. And you need to protect your loved ones. And if somebody breaks into your home, that's their problem, not yours. You know, if somebody does something with a car, I mean, it's their problem. If they get hurt, that's their problem. But we are to love people. I'm not talking about these type of people now. We can love them afterwards. But we got to treat them first. But you have enemies in church. I found this out. When you have a large church, you have different families. There are fights in families. Then families fight one another. Then you got different groups. And so there's always strife, you know. And so we need to learn this. A person might not be lovable. They might do us harm. They might gossip about us and stuff like this. But we need to love them. I've been hurt many years. There was a time, I've said it twice in my life. I will never make another friend. Never again. I'll be civil, I'll be nice, but I don't want any more friends. It hurts too much when they turn on you. And God said, you can't live like that. You know, that's what we want to do when we get hurt. Cut people off. But we've got to love them. This is going to take the Holy Ghost. You and I don't have this. I don't have this in myself. It will take the Holy Ghost. Let me take it to Proverbs 25:21. That's Proverbs 25:21. And we read from the following verse there, 25. Picking up verse 21. If your enemy be hungry, give him bread to eat. If he be thirsty, give him water to drink. For you should heap coals of fire upon his head, and the Lord shall reward you. If your enemy be hungry, give him bread to eat. If he be thirsty, give him water to drink. For you should heap coals of fire upon his head, and the Lord shall reward you. During World War II, the United States went to war with Germany and Japan. And in this country, we hated the Krauts. And it was a long, hard fight. And I remember one man that was a member of my church some time back. He was in American infantry, and he was in Italy. He said, we took no prisoners. We got those SS units in front of us. These were Waffen SS, not the SS with the camps. He said, we took no prisoners. We shot those bees dead. He said, I had no mercy on them. But after the war, and we got to hand this to the leadership. We might not care for Harry Truman as much as some of the people. But you think about this. We were bitter enemies with Germany. We were bitter enemies with the Japs. We hated them. They hated us. But the United States rebuilt Germany. We rebuilt Japan. And today, there's a friendship between these three countries. How was it possible? We did exactly what the Bible says. We gave food to our enemies. We rebuilt them. And we became friends. Matthew 5:44. Matthew 5. Verse number 44. But I say to you, Jesus said, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. We have enemies around us, the jobs, everyday life. There's always people that don't like you. They try to give you a bad time. But these are the words of Jesus. But I said to you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. You want to be like Jesus? Then act like Jesus. Is this something we can say, okay, I'm going to do that today? No. You need to pray. You need to die to yourself. And you need to have the love of God, the Holy Ghost power, the baptism of the Holy Spirit is what you need to be able to live like this. But I can tell you this. When you live like this, your body is going to be in harmony. Your joy is going to be full. You're going to be happy. You're going to be content. Because when you are at peace with people, you will be at peace with God. You see, you can't say, oh, God, I love you, but I hate him. Can't do that. God, I love you. And Lord, I don't like this guy. But Father God, help me to love that turkey. I want him to be dead, but I need to love him, Lord. Oh, God, help me. And you start praying for them. You start praying for the people that you don't like. And suddenly you like them. These are the words of Jesus. Sympathize. Be like-minded. Don't be a snob. Don't be conceited. Don't be high-minded. Don't take vengeance. Be honest. Be peaceful. And love your enemies. You know what? That's the gospel. One page. That's the gospel. And I would say this. If you and I live like that, we could have a great time. I want to say this one thing before I close. We had a church split going back in 2013. And my wife and I had worked hard to build this church up. We put everything we had into it. And the church split was over music, personalities. And two factions, it was actually a small group in the church. Didn't like the music we had, didn't like the worship team we had. And they worked under the surface, sowed discord, and destroyed everything. And it ended up where we closed the building down. Everything was scattered, people were scattered. We got a remnant that we brought up here. We made a chapel here. And now God's rebuilding. And you know, all the income, because my wife and I, we live, I have a salary. Church was gone. And what would happen? But I'm going to tell you this. I didn't hate these people. I prayed for them. I met some of them afterwards. But God was faithful. And God took care of us from day one. When we had 6 people left of the congregation, God, you begin to use the internet to bring in the funds. And God has restored 100-fold what we lost in that church. I can look at all these people today and think about them. I'm not bitter. I'm not angry. I can love them. I can talk with them. I met some of them. But God healed me. And I simply walked away. I didn't say a bad word. I didn't chew anyone out. I didn't start a campaign against them. And if you live like that, you lose your job, God give a better one. You lose your house, whatever it is, God give a better one. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. The choice is yours. I have laid out, as the Holy Spirit gave me today, the way to live a Christian life. It's up to you to live it. I cannot do it for you. Now, you've been listening and said, I'm not saved. How do I get in? Easy. All you need to do right now is to say, my Heavenly Father, I am a sinner. I believe that you are there, God. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe he died on the cross, rose on the third day. And Jesus saved me. Save me right now. And he will. In a few minutes, when we finish here, Charles Torell is going to come. You're not going to see him. But he will come with a voice. He would read some scriptures. He would then pray with you and lead you in a prayer of salvation. You can be saved today. If you get saved today, would you call us? Write us? Let me know that I got saved on such and such a date so I can rejoice with you and give you some stuff that we have. To those of you that are saved, walking with the Lord, I pray that today was encouragement to you. And if you need a tune-up, you know what? Get an alignment. It's free of charge. Get your tires rotated. Get your vehicle fixed up so you can run in top-notch condition. It's nice to run that way. Brother Thomas.
Father God, thank you for the word here today, Lord, on living the Christian life. We thank you, Father God, that we are not left in the dark on this planet, but we have the Word of God. And Lord, we lift up the United States of America to you and all countries around the globe, Lord. And we know that the people have been manipulated throughout history. We know that governments have been manipulated. We know that corruption is the name of the game. So we pray against the corruption, and we have plenty of it here in the USA. And we thank you, Father God, that those that are wrongfully convicted, those that are in prison, that are political prisoners, those that do not belong there, that you would open the prison doors, Lord. And we lift up righteousness in the land of the free and the home of the brave, that it return to righteousness, Lord. And we pray against all this wicked media that we are bombarded with on a daily basis. And all their little mind games and their psyops to pervert the minds of the people. We pray against that, and we thank you for righteousness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth, and your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you 3 questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? Even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all 3 questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these 3 questions are but 3 of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7-8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are 3 places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of 2 places: heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past. And there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 25th part in the series, The Letter to the Romans, and was entitled Christian Conduct. This week, we continue to examine Paul's brilliant one-liners about personal attitudes and our behavior toward others. Christians should interact and sympathize with everyone. This means that when someone is happy, we rejoice with them, and when someone is grieving, we also provide comfort as they work it out. We should strive to be in agreement with other Christians. Can you imagine how the world would be better if there was unity and denominations came to an end? We should also never look down upon others. A deeply committed Christian is never proud and condescending. Likewise, we should never take revenge and rejoice in the pain experienced by others. Unless you're a protege of the devil, this type of behavior is simply not condoned. If Jesus is your Lord and Savior, then you should strive to eliminate any kind of deceit in your life. Don't be contentious and create strife. Be peaceful and a good neighbor. Finally, love your enemy and reach out to them. In doing so, you will shame them, and it is like heaping hot coals on their head. God is light and love, and we should strive to be Christ-like during our time on earth. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1597. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.